suggest you hit that subscribe button, like the video, and leave a comment down below. We are a growing family, so come on over and join the family. And I post videos every Monday, Tuesdays, and Thursdays. I don't have a set time of when I post, but make sure you have that post notification bell on so you'll know when I post a new video.
Twice.
12 of his victims and kept some of their heads as trophies of his violent acts. In 1975, Ted Bundy was pulled over. The police began searching his vehicle and discovered he had a collection of burglary tools, crowbars, face masks, ropes, and handcuffs. He was arrested for having these items in his possession. He was later linked to other heinous crimes. Ted escaped from prison twice. The first time being in 1977, he took a trip to the courthouse library. He jumped out of the window and escaped for 8 days. In December of 1977, he purposely lost 30 pounds so he could fit through a small hole he made in the ceiling of his cell. Officers did not realize that he was missing for 15 hours, which gave him a huge head start on the police. During his second escape, Ted made his way to Tallahassee, Florida, and broke into the Chi Omega sorority house on the night of January 14th, 1978. He attacked 4 female residents, killing 2 of them. Ted was identified in the Chi Omega murders because he bit one of the women. His teeth marks help identify him. That same month, Ted was pulled over and was sent back to prison. On February 9th, Ted kidnapped and murdered a 12-year-old girl, Kimberly Leach. That would be his last victim. Ted represented himself during his trial. He confessed to 30 murders, but the actual number of victims will never be known. Most of the bodies have never been recovered. Ted was sentenced to death and died in the electric chair on January 24th, 1989. Ted's Volkswagen is on display at the Alcatraz East Crime Museum in Tennessee. Jeffrey Dahmer was born on May 21st, 1960. In Milwaukee, Wisconsin, to parents Lionel and Joyce Dahmer. Jeffrey grew up energetic and happy until the age of 4, when he had to undergo surgery to correct a double hernia. The surgery seemed to have an effect on him. His parents noticed he increasingly became withdrawn. The Dahmer family would frequently move from place to place. By his teenage years, he was disengaged, very tense, and didn't have many friends. Jeffrey attended Revere High School. He made average grades and worked on school newspapers. He developed a drinking problem because of the problems he was dealing with at home. His parents divorced when Jeffrey was 18. He lived with just his father, who wasn't at home with him often. He was too busy building a relationship with his new wife. After graduating high school, Jeffrey enrolled at Ohio State University. He would spend most of his time drinking and skipping class. After 2 semesters, he dropped out and returned home with his father. His father gave him 2 options: to get a job or join the army. In 1979, Jeffrey enlisted in the army for 6 years. He remained heavily drinking, and after 2 years, he was discharged. 1978, Jeffrey was struggling with his sexuality, homosexual desires, and he had the urge to act of sadistic fantasies. Unfortunately, his struggles led him to harm others. One evening, he picked up an hitchhiker, 18-year-old Stephen Hicks. He invited him over to his father's house, offered him a drink. When Stephen decided he wanted to leave, Jeffrey hit him in the head with a barbell, killing him. Jeffrey cut up Stephen's body and buried them in the woods around his father's house. Years later, when he confessed as to why he killed Stephen, he simply said he did not want him to leave. Jeffrey would meet his victims at gay bars and lure them by offering them free alcohol and money if they agreed to pose for pictures. His victims were all male, and he would pick people that the police would not care about. He would drug them, sometimes torture them, and then kill them, usually by strangulation. He would keep parts of the body and clean it. Killing his victims in his grandmother's house was getting out of hand and becoming hard to hide. He was working as a mixer at September of 1988, Jeffrey rented out a one-bedroom apartment, apartment 213 on North 24th Street in Milwaukee. Apartment 213 is where he turned it up a notch. Jeffrey would steal me his victims at gay bars, bring them back to his apartment, drug them, torture, kill, and refrigerate their body parts, and sometimes he would cook and eat them so he could become a part of them. In the early morning of May 27th, 1981, Jeffrey's 13th victim, a 14-year-old boy, who was actually the younger brother of a boy Jeffrey was convicted of molesting back in 1989, was seen wandering the streets naked and very disheveled. Two women found the boy and called the police. When police and paramedics arrived on the scene, Jeffrey actually told the police that the young boy was his 19-year-old lover and he was drunk and decided to wander off. The women went back in their house because they thought it was taken care of. When one of the women went back out, Jeffrey, the boy, and the police were gone. Turns out the police escorted Jeffrey and the boy back to Jeffrey's apartment. The two police officers, John and Joseph, joked about escorting two lovers back to Jeffrey's apartment with their dispatcher. Within hours, the boy was killed. On July 22nd, 1991, Jeffrey picked up what he thought was going to be his 18th victim, Tracy Edwards. According to Mr. Edwards, Jeffrey attempted to handcuff him and the two struggled. Tracy escaped and was spotted by police around midnight with a handcuff dangling from his wrist. Police assumed that he escaped from authorities, so they stopped and questioned him. Tracy immediately told them what happened and led them to Jeffrey's apartment. Dahmer opened the door and answered all of police questions calmly. When he went to grab the key to unlock Tracy's handcuffs, one of the officers followed him and glanced around at his apartment. He noticed pictures of bodies in a refrigerator full of human skulls. They attempted to arrest Dahmer, but he put up a struggle. Once they successfully handcuffed him, the police began their search of the apartment and quickly discovered skulls and other human body parts, along with the numerous photos Jeffrey had taken of his victims and the crimes. The evidence that was found in Jeffrey's apartment were horrific. These were the items that were found in his apartment. In the refrigerator, a human head, three bags of organs, which included two hearts, three more heads, a torso, several internal organs were inside a freezer, chemicals were found, two skulls, two hands, a male genitalia were found in the closet, a filing cabinet contained three painted skulls, a skeleton, a dried scalp, male genitalia, and several pictures, victims' IDs, claw hammer, hand saw, and drills, a blood-soaked mattress, a hypodermic needle, pornographic videos, and a Bible. Jeffrey was indicted on 17 murder charges. He pleaded not guilty as reason of insanity. Jeffrey had written a 160-page confession. Many witnesses testified that his urges were so strong, he was unable to control them. The defense proved that he was in control and capable of planning, manipulating, and covering up his crimes. The jury deliberated for 5 hours and returned with a verdict of guilty on 15 counts of murder. Jeffrey was sentenced to 937 years in prison. After his sentencing, Jeffrey calmly read a statement to apologize for what he has done. Your Honor, it is now over. This has never been a case of trying to get free. I didn't ever want freedom. Frankly, I wanted death for myself. This was a case to tell the world that I did what I did, but not for reasons of hate. I hated no one. I knew I was sick or evil or both. Now I believe I was sick. The doctors have told me about my sickness, and now I have some peace. I know how much harm I have caused. Thank God there will be no more harm that I can do. I believe that only the Lord Jesus Christ can since I asked for no consideration. Jeffrey was originally sent to Columbia Correctional Institute in Wisconsin. He was separated from the general prison population for his own safety. Eventually, he was permitted to have some contact with other inmates. November 28, 1994, Jeffrey and another inmate, Jesse, were beaten to death by inmate Christopher Scarver while working in the prison gym. Jesse was in prison for killing his wife, and Christopher was a schizophrenic convicted of first-degree murder. For unknown reasons, the guards left the three of them alone for 20 minutes. The officers returned to find Jess dead and Jeffrey dying from severe head trauma. Jeffrey died in the ambulance before reaching the hospital. When asked why he did it, Christopher simply said, "Because God told him to." Charles Miles Maddox was born on November 12, 1934, in Cincinnati, Ohio, to Kathleen Maddox, who was 16 years old at the time. She was an alcoholic and a prostitute. Kathleen later married William Manson, but the marriage did not last long. Charles was placed in a boys' school at the age of 12. He wasn't allowed to return to his mother, so he was living on the streets and getting by through petty crime. Charles spent the next 20 years in and out of reform schools and prisons for numerous crimes. In 1955, Charles married Rosalie Jean Willis, who was a 17-year-old hospital waitress. They had a son together, Charles Mason Jr. They moved to California. By 1956, Rosalie left Charles to be with someone else. Charles married a prostitute named Leona Ray Stevens. They had a child together named Charles Luther Manson. Leona divorced Charles in 1963. Charles' first son, Charles Mason Jr., committed suicide in 1993. Charles Manson created the Manson family, which was about 100 followers of Charles who shared the same passion for sadistic things like an unusual lifestyle and the use of hallucinating drugs, LSD, and shrooms. The Manson family consisted of young girls that believed Charles was Jesus and his prophecies of a race war. The Manson family moved from San Francisco to an unoccupied ranch in San Fernando Valley. The song Helter Skelter was a song from the Beatles' 1968 album. Charles took the lyrics seriously to justify his plan and guide his followers to murder. In August of 1969, Charles gathered a group of his cult to carry out his massacre against the beautiful people in Hollywood. The Manson family would invite people in, find people on the street, or break into their homes. They would kill their victims by shooting or stabbing them to death. Sharon Tate was 8 months pregnant when she was murdered. As she was being tortured, she begged for the life of her unborn child. She was repeatedly stabbed in the stomach, and one of the Manson's family members said, "Look, bitch, I have no mercy for you. You're going to die, and you better get used to it." The family member used Sharon's blood to write the word pig on the front door. After the murder was complete, Charles criticized the members for being sloppy. The Manson cult were arrested because police had suspicion they vandalized a portion of the Death Valley National Park while they were hiding out in the Mojave Desert. In 1969, the county sheriffs took them into custody. One of the members, Susan Atkins, confessed to murdering Gary Hinman. The Manson family had a list of celebrities that they wanted to kill, which included Elizabeth Taylor, her husband Richard Burton, Frank Sinatra, Steve McQueen, and Tom Jones. When asked why they wanted to kill celebrities, they responded with wanting to commit murders. that would shock the world and make people take notice. The trial began in June of 1970. They had a lawyer named Ronald Hughes for Charles and one of the members, Van Houten. Ronald dropped Charles as a client, allegedly, because he felt like Charles could convince the jury that Van Houten was influenced by the family leader. Later that year, Ronald went camping and disappeared. His decomposed body was found several months later. During the trial, Charles released an album called Lie to try to raise money for his defense. Charles showed up to trial with an X carved in his forehead. Some of his female followers carved an X in their forehead and shaved their heads. Throughout the trial, the family would giggle and smirk with Charles, showing no remorse for their crimes. On January 25th, 1971, Charles Manson was convicted of first-degree murder for directing two murders. He was sentenced to death, but he was changed to life in prison after California's Supreme Court invalidated all death sentences prior to 1972. He was sentenced to life in prison and spent the next four decades behind bars. Linda Casabian, who was one of the family members, was given immunity for her part as a witness. Susan Atkins, who was a member of the family, was sentenced to death, but her sentence was later changed to life in prison. She was incarcerated from 1969 until her death in 2009. On November 19th, 2017, Charles Manson died at 83 years old. He went into cardiac arrest due to respiratory failure and colon cancer. He spent 40 years in prison before his death. Dennis Lynn Radar was born on March 9, 1945 in Pittsburgh, Kansas, to parents Dorothea May Radar and William Elvin Radar. He grew up in Wichita and was the oldest of three other brothers, Paul, Bill, and Jeff. Overall, he had a pretty normal childhood. His parents worked long hours, so they really didn't pay much attention to their children. Dennis explained later on that he felt ignored by his mother and resented her because of that. He kept a huge secret from everyone that he had a fascination about hanging stray animals. In the mid-1960s, Dennis attended Kansas Wesleyan University after college. He couldn't maintain decent grades, so he dropped out after 1 year and decided to join the U.S. Force from 1966 to 1970. After the discharge, Dennis returned to Wichita, where he met and married a woman named Paula in 1971, and they had two children, Carrie and Brian. Dennis enrolled at Butler County Community College and earned his associate's degree in electronics in 1973. He then enrolled at Wichita State University and graduated in 1979 with a bachelor's degree in administration of justice. For a short period of time, he worked as an assembler for the Coleman Company, which is an outdoor supply company, from 1974 to 1988. He worked at the base office of ADT Security Services, where he would go to people's homes and install security alarms. In 1991, Dennis became a dog catcher and compliance officer in Park City. People would describe him as being strict, and they reported he would harass single women, and one person even reported that he killed her dog for no reason. Dennis was a member of Christ Lutheran Church and had been elected as president of the church council. Dennis was even a club scout leader for the Boy Scouts. Dennis cross-dressed and would masturbate in women's clothing. He would go as far as tying ropes around his arms and neck. Later on, he admitted the reason he did this was because he was pretending to be his victims as part of a sexual fantasy. Dennis would also spy on his female neighbors while dressed as a woman. Dennis Rader gave himself the name projects or potential hits. He later said, quote, "If one didn't work out, I just moved to another one." BTK prepared a hit kit, which consisted of ropes, zip ties, ski mask, and extra clothes that he called hit clothes, which he would wear, then later get rid of. BTK would force his way into people's homes. After killing them, he removed one of the victims, stripped her down, tied her up, and took pictures of what he did. In 2004, BTK would send letters to the Wichita Eagle in response to where his whereabouts were. He would write things like, "How many do I have to kill before I get my name in the paper or some national attention? It's hard to control myself. You probably call me psychotic with a sexual perversion." BTK would play this cat and mouse game by sending police crossword puzzles, dolls that posed like these victims, and he would call in to tell police where they could find the next homicide. On February 12th, 2005, BTK was driving not too far from his home when he was pulled over and arrested. The Wichita Police, FBI, and ATF agents searched his home and his vehicle. They found computer equipment, a pair of pantyhose, and a huge container. In June of 2005, BTK pled guilty, and in August of 2005, he was sentenced to 10 life sentences in prison. During his confession, he explained in detail how he found victims and how he murdered them. He showed little to no emotion and never apologized for what he did. Dennis is now 75 years old and is currently in solitary confinement at El Dorado Correctional Facility in Butler County, Kansas. Back in July of 2005, his wife Paula filed for an emergency divorce from him. His daughter Carrie released a book called A Serial Killer's Daughter. His son Bryant remains silent and stays out of the media. John Wayne Gacy was born on March 17, 1942, in Chicago, Illinois, to parents John Stanley Gacy and Marion Elaine Robinson. John was close to his mother and two sisters, but had a rocky relationship with his father. John's father was an alcoholic. He would beat John and his siblings and belittle them. John's sister Karen said that John was so used to the beatings that over time he would not cry. John would also experience his mother getting beat by his father. John got molested a few times by a family friend in their truck. He never told his father because he believed his father would blame him for the abuse. As a kid, John was chunky and unathletic. He suffered from a heart condition and was told to avoid sports. In the fourth grade, John would pass out often and was hospitalized occasionally because of this, and his appendix burst in 1957. Between ages 14 and 18, he was in and out of the hospital for almost a year. His father believed John had these episodes to gain attention and sympathy and accused his son of being fake. 1960, 18-year-old John became involved in politics and worked as an assistant for a Democratic Party. He found a job in Las Vegas in the ambulance service field. He worked there for a little while before being transferred to work in a morgue as a mortuary assistant, where he worked for 3 months. John slept behind the embalming room on a cot. Later on, he admitted to getting in the coffin of a deceased teenage male and caressed his body. After doing this, John went into so much shock, the next day he left Las Vegas and went back home to Chicago. After returning home, he enrolled at Northwestern Business College. He graduated in 1963 and took a management trainee position with a shoe company. In 1964, the shoe company transferred him to Springfield, Illinois to work as a salesman, and he was shortly promoted to a manager position of his department. March of 1964, he met and became engaged to Marilyn Myers, who was a co-worker. father apologize for his wrongdoings when John was growing up. John opened up a club in his basement where people could come and play pool and drink alcohol. John would make sexual advances after they got drunk. If the boys turned him down, he would choke it off. John was a member of Jolly Joker Clown Club and would perform as a clown at children's parties, fundraisers, and other events. His alter ego was Pogo the Clown or Patches the Clown. John would lure his victims, which were young boys, with the promise of construction work, money, and other things. He would abduct, sexual assault, torture, then kill his victims by strangulation. John later confessed that, quote, clowns can get away with murder. There were rumors going around Chicago that there was a man named John picking up young men. Police would sit outside of John's house and saw young men going in and out of his home. When police questioned the boys, they didn't say anything against John. Police ran a background check on John and quickly discovered they had a search warrant on his home. On December 13, 1978, his home was searched and they found a driver's license, college ring that was linked to be one of the boys, but no bodies were discovered yet. They smelled a very odd smell coming from a broken drain. John was placed on a 24-hour surveillance watch and police questioned the neighbors. Police did a more extensive search at John's home and discovered 27 bodies in a crawl space and a few bodies that were thrown in a nearby river when the crawl space became too crowded. John confessed to 30 murders and his trial began on February 6, 1980. There were arguments on whether or not he could be declared insane and sent to a mental state facility. John told police that he did not commit the crimes. One of his other personalities did. John was found guilty of 33 murders and was sentenced to 12 death sentences and 21 natural sentences. He was sent to Menard Correctional Center in Illinois, where he served over 10 years. While in prison, John would paint, and his paintings were shown to the public at an art gallery in Chicago. Thank you all so much for watching the video. If you all enjoyed this type of content, go ahead and hit that subscribe button, like the video, and leave me a comment down below.